Snowpath is investigating already. Looking at having about 1,500 campouts with the chip, and then other programs, that name, emergency chips, and data sets. So at this point, over 6,000 genotypes have been ordered, you know, or chips are about 6,000 genotypes have been ordered worldwide. So I don't know where, you know, who has those chips or whatever, but we have a large number in the U.S., but over Europe, they've invested in that. So I think that this is going to be a success. Okay. So kind of getting back to the procedure here, is that I think what we need to have is a high quality unit. And it's kind of funny that something that's been around for a decade is kind of one of the bugaboos of the whole process. Is, and this is just local potatoes, those are tomatoes too, is the simple process of isolating high quality DNA at a concentration rate has been some of our holdups in the process. And so we've been recommending either try a different method. But importantly is that Illumina says that they quantify the DNA using the Selene assay, and that's the invisible DNA. And we need to adjust the concentration of 50 nanograms per microliter. And so we need about 50 microliters to make sure we have enough to do the analysis. And we have, as Dr. says, it's something 96 well placed with some of the oil kill cover would be the best way to receive this. Okay? So we receive it in many different ways. But the key is this concentration. And if you're using each chip holds 24 genotypes. And so each chip costs over $2,000. So we want to make sure that this is right. And so we turn on the chip on the DNA quality and concentration. I will admit that we put samples on less than 50 nanograms per microliter. I think it's a little bit lower than that. I mean, it has worked out, but it's nice to do this as a standard. Okay. And, I'll just step back here. I put in there, thank you to Dan Farnder, because every chip that we've done has worked right now. I can't imagine what it would be like if we had some failures. We've been getting excellent data, and Dan Farnder has been taking on the responsibility of doing the genotyping. I'm afraid to prove anybody else has been so successful at that. And so it's truly a three-day procedure. I'm really looking to make something seem a little better than it really is. And finally, we'll something about a week.
For you.
So you can see here, we just don't have any close range scattering of dots all over the place. Here, we're not seeing any type of segregation going on for the positive or pairing. Here again, just a cloud, and then here, I was talking about that when it's close to the bottom here, but close to the impact, then it's kind of questionable whether we're going to call on that. So, there's many more bands we have called them. Okay, so we have the answer to Robin's condition that kind of gone through the diversity panel and the Russian rabbit population and the diploid map population, and then step by step, over the 1800 steps to make her call, sorry, not that, and just made it the same. So of those 1800, she felt that 2412 were good calls. So this is over broad, drop by space, which is making this information. And then in the other part here, flexible segregation and flexible bad segregation. And then here's a call rate for the good markers. Now over 90% of them are 7,000 of them have a 90% good call rate. Okay? So these are the ones that we want to work with. So we built around those 900 bad steps. Okay? Basically, it's only 900 steps. Okay, so these are the steps that we want to move through here. Is we're going to walk through this process here. So you can go to this website here, grab the data file, and you can remove the banned questionable snips. So you can go in there, there's a list of them there, you can align it with your data that came off. You can also remove snips that have multiple locations, since you have one of those up, again, in the same file. We've got to remove the parental genotypes that do not agree across the repetition that got illogical. We want to remove snips if we don't have a genotype for one of the parents. You know, it's not somebody to work with, why would you want to, if there was no call on time? We also, then, this is kind of a perspective, is if we thought there was too much missing data for a specific snip, we tried to exclude it from the analysis. And of course, as both home scientists, we excluded it and removed unexpected genotypes. So it's sort of a heterogeneous, but kind of a pretty good group that was in the most good. We also removed ones that had highly distorted segregation or no segregation. And now, some of the ones that I listed here are ones that we're going to walk through in a joint map. We're going to remove the no segregating steps. And also, we're going to individuals that are identical at all and all those sides. We're going to have those groupings. So we're going to select groups for mapping, determine a marker order. But yes, we can actually go back and add in the co-segregating steps, and we can compare these to pseudo molecule, the Robin talked about, and we can determine the chromosomes that some people are supposed to have, and also calculate the map size. So the question is, what's the rationale for the co-segregating steps? For the simplicity of running joint maps, we're going to choose one for each combination. So we don't need to have all of them, the steps that map to the same spot. They're because of the combination, so they're just make the map overpopulated with markers that are not really important to them. So we put them back in after we do, but we don't want to lose them, but to run the map, you can use any of the ones that you want that did co-segregate.